out, enjoying our freedom in America. And we are thankful to live in this country. We are more thankful, though, for our freedom that we possess in Christ, because we have a Savior who has died in our place and has resurrected in our place so that we can be ultimately free forever. And so thankful that we get to worship Him today together. And I was reading just a couple days ago about Paul, and he's in 1 Thessalonians, and Paul mentions to the Thessalonians, commenting about their faith, and he says, "You received the word with joy in the Holy Spirit, even in much affliction." That's in 1 Thessalonians 1. And I think that's what my heart is for us this morning, is that we would receive the word with joy. We kind of are walking through a season of affliction in many ways. And may we receive the word with joy in the Holy Spirit today, even though we're walking through a tough season. So thankful for you. Let me pray, and Pastor Roger is going to lead us in worship this morning. Let's pray together. Father, we love you, and we are so thankful to know you and know the freedom that comes in Christ. God, we are thankful, and we are blessed beyond what we deserve to live in a country such as this. God, with all our faults and failures in America, we thank you for where you have placed us for such a time as this, in this season we live. God, may we not abuse the freedoms that we have as Americans, but use them to glorify and proclaim the name of Jesus. God, we pray that we would love and enjoy our freedom that we possess in Christ. God, that we would glorify your name with our life, not use our freedom to sin, but use our freedom to do good works in the name of Jesus. We pray that this morning, as we begin our worship service, you'd prepare our hearts to praise you, to study your word, and may we ultimately receive your word with joy in the Holy Spirit and be strengthened. And we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's such an honor for me to be in here and singing with you this morning. For the past several weeks, I've been in the little room back in the back helping with the video stuff, but sure good to be here with you. I wish I could see your smiling faces, but just want to encourage you to sing with us. We have some wonderful songs to sing about God's faithfulness, His abiding love, and the fact that we can always trust Him no matter what's going on. Let me encourage you just to sing out where you are this morning as when we stand in just a second. I read just yesterday that there is a state that has mandated that churches not sing because it's not as safe as not singing. So, but you've got your mask on, and I think it's pretty safe. But if you're comfortable with that, I want to encourage you to sing out where you are today. Let's worship the Lord. We're going to sing this great song, Jesus, Firm Foundation. Would you stand up? Let's worship Him together.
How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in His excellent word. What more can He say than to you He has said? To you who for refuge to Jesus have
age he stands.
You.
sing this great hymn.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with me. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail.
Standing, I want to pray, and then we're going to sing that chorus one more time before we sit down. Let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful to you today that no matter what's going on in our world, in our nation, threats of disease, threats of unsettledness, Lord, we can rest. We can trust that you, no matter the circumstances, we know that you are in control. You've got it. You've got us. So we rest in you today. We thank you for your wonderful love and faithfulness toward us, your people who love you. We've given our lives to you, Lord, and we trust you. We want to affirm that one more time as we sing this beautiful chorus together. Lord, you're so great in your faithfulness. Sing it to me again.
Great is thy
good to see you this morning, bright and early out there, and it is apparently, see if I can get this on, I know how to wear this thing, apparently it is vacation season, and so Trevor's gone, Brian's gone, and I just have been on a staycation. My brother and his family are actually still here, they're leaving this morning, and so we've been with them for a week, and so we have been staying up late and eating a lot of food, and so if I don't sound like I'm making a whole lot of sense, it's because I'm tired. It's because I'm really, really tired, but I am grateful to be here with you this morning, bright and early. If you have your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 10. Now, typically what I do is, as you know, most of the time I will look through a passage of Scripture and just kind of focus in on that one scripture. And I want to do something different this morning. And I want to go to several different places in Scripture. And I've been thinking and mulling through what I wanted to say this morning and talking about this particular issue. And with all that is going on in our country and the unsettled nature, I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like it weighs very heavy. You ever feel like that? Is it weighing heavy on you? And so we certainly need to, as 1 Peter 5 says, cast our cares to God because He cares. And so I love some of the songs that we sang this morning because it reminds us that even in the midst of uncertain times, we can rest on the one who is sure. But I have really been wrestling with so many different issues in my mind and in my heart, and just a lot that's burdening me. And I feel like we're in very, very difficult days. And so we rest upon the solid rock of Christ, trusting in Him. And one of the things that I've really been thinking about is the issue of authority. The issue of authority. Now, of course, with the police issues that we have experienced, there has been certainly the abuse of authority. I would say no one in their right mind could ever agree that what that police officer in Minneapolis did to George Floyd was right. Under no circumstances could you ever dream up that what he did was right, in my mind. And so there is abuse of authority. There always has been abuse of authority, and unfortunately there always will be. That is reality. It is sin in our world. But then you flip on the other side, and there is the seemingly disregard for authority in our country right now with violence, with rioting, those kinds of things. And so you have basically on one side you have the abuse of authority, and the other side you have the unacceptance of authority, and maybe some situations where it feels like anarchy is trying to reign in our country. And so the issue, though, is authority. The issue is authority. And when you boil it down to, you look at a lot of what the Bible has to say, the Bible has a lot to say about authority. Now, I don't want to really talk this morning about that we are to submit to authority in the sense of human authorities, which, by the way, we are. And that is not something we enjoy doing. In fact, I would say this, as Americans, we struggle with many, many times, we struggle with submitting to our human authorities, especially when they don't agree with us. If they don't agree with our political persuasion, if they don't agree or we don't agree with their stance or whatever, we have a very difficult time submitting to authority. I was talking to Jonathan Smith, and he was talking about the restrictions that the country of Peru has put on their citizens because of COVID, and basically for months they could not even leave their house. The three Smith boys did not leave their house for months, and when I mean did not leave their house, they literally did not go outside. And so we were talking about that and how un-American that is, and how we struggle with that. And so there are certainly issues with that. The whole thing gets very complex and complicated, and I haven't even wrapped my mind around it yet because I feel like it up to this point there has not really been a religious persecution with the COVID thing, but I feel like at some point it comes very close to that. And then at some point it could cross the line where COVID becomes an excuse for religious persecution. And so there's just, it's so many complicated things to wrap my mind around, and these are uncertain days. But I can tell you this, that we do need to trust in Christ and in Christ alone. He's the one that can bring you peace, just as we've just sung. And we can rest in His grace. We can rest and trust in His peace. And through all of those uncertainties, we can trust in Him. But speaking of authority, what I wanted to do is I want to talk about us as followers of Christ and how we are to submit to the authority of Christ. How are we submit to the authority of Christ? Because Scripture has a lot to say about that. In fact, Jesus himself had a lot to say about submitting to the authority of him, the authority of Christ. In Luke chapter 7, you don't have to turn there. I want you to turn to Luke chapter 10. But in Luke chapter 7, we find a very interesting passage of Scripture. And in Luke 7 verse 9, you'll see this on your screen. Here's what it says. It says, when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, said, I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith. I believe I read that there are 32 times in the Gospels where it said that Jesus was teaching, and the people were amazed at his teaching. He used that word amazed, or the ESV uses the word marvel. It means that they were absolutely amazed at the teaching that of Jesus, and oftentimes they were amazed because it says that he was teaching as one with authority. In other words, what he said goes. He wasn't just relying on what another rabbi had said. He was teaching and preaching from authority and said, this is what I say, Scripture says, and this is what I say. And so the people marveled, they were amazed at his teaching. But I want you to know there are two times in the Gospels where it says that Jesus was amazed. Now, you got to get up pretty early in the morning to amaze Jesus, don't you? I mean, I want you to think about that. Jesus is the second person of the Trinity. The Bible is very clear that Jesus is the creator. He created everything that we know, everything that we see and experience, and here he is being God himself, became and transitioned, took on flesh, became a man, was witness to what God was doing in and through him. He was performing miracles. You've got to get up pretty early in the morning to amaze Jesus. So what in the world amazed Jesus? Well, in Luke chapter 7, I just read that, it is what amazed Jesus was the faith of a centurion, was the faith of a Gentile, a non-Jew. Said after he had finished all his sayings, don't even turn there, after he had finished all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum, and there was a centurion who had a servant who was sick and at the point of death, who was highly valued by him. When the centurion heard about Jesus, he sent to him elders of the Jews and asking him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they pleaded with him earnestly, saying, he is worthy to have you do this for him, for he loves our nation, and he is the one who built us our synagogue. And Jesus went with them. When he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends, saying to him, Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you, but say the word, and let my servant be healed. Now, here's the key. For I too am a man set under authority with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does that. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, said, I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith. So this is the faith that amazes Jesus, the faith of a Gentile, the faith of a centurion who tells Jesus, you can heal my child, and you know what? You won't even have to worry about Jesus. Don't even come. You don't have to come to my house. Just say the word, and they will be healed. Because he had such faith, because he understood authority. And he understood the authority of Jesus. And that is why Jesus marvels at it. This is why Jesus is amazed at this man's faith. It's not just his faith, but the reason he had faith was because he was submitting to authority. He understood authority. The problem with many of us, we don't understand authority. Listen, that's why it is so important that even as little children, we teach out, as parents and as church leaders, we teach our children about authority. Because we live in a world that will always be based on some kind of authority, whether we like it or not. And ultimately, we have to surrender and submit to the authority of God, the authority of Jesus Christ. And so when you look through the other parts of the New Testament, you begin to see this, and it begins to be very, very clear about surrendering to the authority of Jesus. So it actually made me think about two of the greatest statements that Jesus has ever made. Two of the greatest statements, we know them as the Great Commission, and we know them as the Great Commandment. The Great Commission and the Great Commandment. Now, you know this just as well as I do. In Matthew chapter 28, Jesus is leaving, and he's telling his disciples, I'm about to leave. And here's exactly what he says, and you know it just as well as I do. He says, and Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven. Now, listen, this is what he's about to give the Great Commission. He's about to tell them, this is what you're to be about. When, how does he start that conversation? With saying that he has all authority. All authority. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Now, look at what it says now. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Here is something I want you to see. The all authority of Jesus should lead to an all commitment on our part. Because Jesus has all authority, that means that we should respond with all commitment. Does that make sense? Because he has all authority, then we ought to respond with allness. And I want you to see what I want you to see this morning, and I don't even really have a point this morning in the sense of point one, point two, point three. But what I want you to see this morning is, it is very clear in the Gospels that there is this key word of authority, and the word is all. The word is all. There's an allness to the authority of Christ, and our surrendering and our submitting to the authority of Christ has to do with our allness. In the Great Commandment, Matthew chapter 22, Jesus was asked this question. As you know, they were trying to trip him up, and they said, hey, which one, teacher, which is the greatest of the commandments of the law? Now, there are a lot of commandments of the law. In fact, the Jewish people had 613 of them. They're like, tell me which one is important. Listen, that's almost like saying, which one of your kids is your favorite? That is a really difficult question, right? I mean, what do you mean which commandment is the most important? They're all important. Like it's saying, which one of the Ten Commandments is important? Well, because if you say one's not important, that means, well, I don't really have to consider that one as much as I do the other one. No, you have to consider all of them. They're all important. So Jesus takes all of those hundreds of commandments, and he distills them down, and he says, I tell you this, you shall love the Lord your God, ready, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Do you see the connection between the Great Commission and the Great Commandment? The connection is the word all. And the connection is even greater than the word all. All has to do on our part, and it has to do with the authority of Christ. So he's taken this word and this phrase from Deuteronomy 6, which is, as you know, is referred to as the Shema. And he says, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Because he is one, then we respond with a oneness. Does that make sense? Listen, because God is one, we respond with oneness. Now, what is oneness? Oneness is allness. We respond with allness. So that is why it makes sense that we are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our soul, all of our mind. You can't, when it comes to worshiping and surrendering to Christ, you don't just give him part, you give him all. You give him all because he is one and because he has all authority. And I love what it says in the Great Commandment, you shall love the Lord your God. Why didn't he just say, you shall love God? He didn't say just you shall love God. He said, you shall love the Lord your God. Why shall you love the Lord? Because the Lord has to do with our surrendering our entirety to who He is. People ask me all the time, can you be saved without accepting Christ as Lord? And I've really thought through that a lot. And people have wondered that, and they've asked that a lot. And I have studied it, and I've thought through it, and I've wrestled with it. But here's the bottom line answer. No. You can't. You can't trust Christ. You can't surrender, and you can't be saved without trusting in Christ as Lord. You have to do. In fact, when I go through Scripture and read what Jesus has to say about salvation, it seems sometimes that Jesus has more to say about accepting Him as Lord than He does accepting Him as Savior. Go back and read it. Sometimes His explanation or His description of salvation doesn't quite always match exactly how we word it. And I'm not saying it's necessarily that different, but it is certainly worded differently. And it has to do with us surrendering to the authority of Christ, to the allness of God, and therefore we are to respond with loving our God, Lord our God, with all of everything about us. We respond to the allness of God with the allness of ourselves. Now, what I want to do real quickly is I want to show you two scriptures that in the Gospels that have to do with this and what Jesus has to say about it. All right, Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, we're going to be in Luke 10, Mark 10. We're going to do this real fast, all right? Luke chapter 10, this is a very interesting passage, but it has to do with what we're talking about. Luke chapter 10, verse 25. You know this passage very, very well, but I want you to see it maybe in a little different light. It says in verse 25, Luke 10, 25, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test." Once again, they're putting him to the test. "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" All right, here we go. Boom. This is it. Jesus, tell us exactly this is what we need to know. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? We would say, what shall I do to get to heaven? What shall I do to spend all eternity with you, Jesus? We want to know. And he said to him, "What is written in the law?" Oh boy, here we go. It's going to get complicated, right? Jesus, I don't want to know. I just tell me. Just tell me what to do and I'll do it, right? But he turns it back on them and he says, "Well, what is written in the law? How do you read it?" In other words, you've read it just as much as I have. You tell me, right? Because this is the lawyer. This is someone who ought to know, all right? And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." We've heard this, right? All right, so he explains it. Here's what it is. I'm going to boil it down to you. Here's the first commandment. The second one is very similar to it. Love the Lord your God with your allness. And then secondly, I want you to love your neighbor as yourself. Boom, there it is. That's what you ought to do to inherit eternal life. Now go and do it. The problem is, that's really difficult, Jesus. And so here's what the lawyer then has to say. And he said to him, "You have answered correctly," or Jesus says, you have answered this correctly, and do this and you will live. So the lawyer, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" So here's where the rubber meets the road. Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all the allness. And then secondly, love your neighbor as yourself. And the guy's like, okay, wait a minute, that sounds great, but there's some neighbors of mine I don't like. Does that mean I have to love them? Jesus, man, I'm telling you, of all anybody that's ever lived, Jesus goes to the heart of the problem. Bam! Jesus does not mess around, so here's what he does. Jesus tells a story. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, you know this, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, here we go. This is Jesus going right to the heart of the matter. He's talking to a guy who hates Samaritans. So why does he talk about Samaritans? Because he's talking to a guy who hates Samaritans. All right? Listen, this is incredible. This is probably one of the most, well, it might be the most well-known parable. And Jesus tells it for a very specific reason, because he's talking to a racist. You can kind of imagine the story that Jesus would probably be telling today. He might not be using Samaritans. He might be using some other ethnicity, some other group. And so a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and then he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take care of him. Whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back." Jesus says, "Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" Jesus looks at him square in the eye. He says, "You tell me, which one was the neighbor? And by the way, I told you, in order to inherit eternal life, you're going to have to love your neighbor." Remember, he had just said that. So now he's like, "So you tell me which one was neighborly." Now, I like I don't like it, but I find it very interesting, the guy's response. And I can imagine Jesus just penetrates right to the heart of the question. "You tell me which one proved to be a neighbor." And I can imagine this guy, this lawyer, goes kind of, "Well, the one who showed him mercy." He wasn't real happy about saying it. Did you notice he couldn't even get the word out? He didn't say the Samaritan. He couldn't even bring himself to say it. He hated them so much. "I'm not even going to say it." "Well, the one who showed him mercy." And Jesus says, "You know what? You're exactly right. Now you go and do likewise." What is Jesus saying here? Jesus is saying to this guy, this lawyer, that in order to inherit eternal life, in order to trust Christ, you've got to submit to the allness of Christ. You can't have one area. You can't love the Lord your God and then not love your neighbor. That's exactly what he's saying. He's like, there is an area, and he knew exactly this area that this lawyer had not surrendered. There was an area of his life that he had not surrendered to the lordship of God. So how can you love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, and he even uses all of your strength, all of your mind? How can you love the Lord your God with all of that when you don't even love your neighbor? Do you see what he's saying? He's like, that's an oxymoron. You can't love the Lord your God if you don't love your neighbor. And you can't love the Lord your God with allness when there's something that you're not surrendering to Christ. I preached a sermon on this one time, and the name of the sermon, I remember it, I called it The Untouchables. There are some untouchables in our lives that we don't want to surrender to Christ. And for some of us, it's 90%. Like, "I'll give you, God, I'll give you this, 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 and this, but this right here, I can't do it." And by the way, I was talking to my daughter about this a couple of weeks ago. There can be something, one thing in your life that will keep you from God. There can be one thing in your life that you're holding back that will keep you from Christ, literally keep you from salvation. Because to be saved, you got to say, "God, I surrender it all. I surrender it all." It doesn't mean that it's a perfect surrender, but you've got to be willing to say, "Jesus, you're the one who makes the rules, and I will submit to that." And so this is exactly what he's saying in Luke chapter 10. He's like, "You know what? The one area of your life, Mr. Lawyer, that you are not willing to submit is your racist heart. The one area you're not willing to submit to is loving your neighbor. Yeah, you want to love certain neighbors, but there's certain neighbors that you want to continue hating." And Jesus is like, "You can't love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength if you're going to continue to do that. And that will keep you from inheriting eternal life. That's what Jesus said. Now, that was Luke chapter 10. Real quickly, turn to Mark 10, and then we're finished. Mark chapter 10. You see the very similar thing. Now, as you know this story from the rich young ruler, or the rich young man, Mark chapter 10, verse 17, we see a very similar situation. And as he was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Same question. Here we go. Tell us, Jesus. Now, don't complicate it, Jesus. Have y'all noticed that Jesus complicates things sometimes? Man, I just love the simplicity sometimes. Sometimes he's incredibly simple. Sometimes he's incredibly complex, and he's always profound. And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother." Basically, what he's done is he's taken the second half of the commandments that have to do with how we love our neighbor and how we love others and how we, because we love God, we are supposed to love others. By the way, you do realize if we were to love exactly the way God tells us to love, there would be no need for the law. Love is greater than the law. That's why the greatest law is love. But he goes on to say, and he says to him, "Teacher, all of these I have kept from my youth." His youth maybe meant from his bar mitzvah, you know. If he was Jew, he's like, you know, I've kept all of those. Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, "You lack one thing. Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor. And you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Now here's a man who missed out on eternal life because he was hanging on to the stuff of this life. Now why did Jesus say something about money to him, but to the other guy he had something to say about a Samaritan? Because it all had to do with the thing that was hanging them, it was holding them up from surrendering to the authority. For some people, it's racism. For some people, it's money. For some people, it's pride. For some people, it's some other kind of sin. It could be 100. It could be 1,000 different things. I've told you this story before, but I was witnessing to this guy one time. We became very good friends, led him to Christ. But the one thing that was really holding him up was go-kart racing. Go-kart racing was about to hinder him from inheriting eternal life because he didn't want to give it. He was like, "This is what I want to do. God's telling me to give it up. I don't want to give it up." He knew it. He knew it. There's nothing wrong with go-kart racing unless Jesus asks you to give it up. It could be anything that Jesus says, "I want you to surrender this to my authority." Is there something in your life that is untouchable? That you're like, "Jesus, I'm not giving you this. I'm holding on to this area in my life." For some of you, maybe there's something in your life that you are unwilling to surrender to the authority of Christ. And because of that, your heart deep down is like a rebel. Because if there's one thing that we are unwilling to give up, sometimes that means that we're unwilling to really give him our allness. Because when we surrender to the authority of Christ, we are surrendering to the lordship of Jesus Christ. He is Lord. And it has been said many, many times, if Jesus is not Lord of all, that means he is not Lord at all. We have to surrender to the lordship of Jesus Christ. Have you done that in your life? Have you surrendered every area of your life? That doesn't mean it's all perfect. It doesn't mean, hey, this, you know, I've got all of this down pat. It doesn't mean that you don't struggle. But at the end of the day, you say, "God, this is something I am giving over to you. Why? Because you are my Lord and because I am surrendering this to you. That means I'm going to give you my all. Every part of my being. God, that's what I want to do because that's what Jesus has asked me to do. Have you surrendered your allness to the allness of Christ? All authority. He's been given all authority. Because of that, we surrender our allness to him. If you have never trusted in Christ as your Lord and Savior, maybe it's because there's something in your life that you've been holding back from him. Is there something you've been holding back? Say, I can't give this over. I want to tell you this. You're like, why would I surrender that over to him? Because the grace, the peace, the allness of Christ is so much better than what you're holding on to. I can tell you that. It is so much better. When you trust that he is worthy to be called Lord, worthy to submit, to be submitted to in your life, would you trust him today? If you've never trusted in the Lord, I want to encourage you to do that today, to surrender to him and say, Jesus, I accept you as my Savior. You're the one who saved me. You died in my place. But I accept you also as my Lord. I will submit my life to you. I will say yes to you and to what you want for my life. I give you my all, Jesus. The old hymn once said, and we've sung it many times, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. All. Would you surrender your allness to him? Maybe some of you have, most of you have trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. But is there something that has snuck up in your life? It's kind of crept into your life, and it's there right now that you have not surrendered to Christ. And it's keeping you from really living a life of freedom, a life of peace. Would you today surrender that area that maybe has been untouchable? Would you surrender? And by the way, you know what that area is. You know what that area is. Would you today, right now, say, Jesus, I confess that sin to you. I confess that area to you. I want to give it over to you. I give it to you. Would you surrender that area of your life over to Jesus right now? Because he's worthy. He's worthy to be given that. And he wants to have authority over your life. Would you do that? Would you do that now? Let's pray together, and then we'll sing. God, we are grateful for your word. We're grateful, Lord, how Jesus, over and over again, you tell us that you have authority, and that authority is good because, Lord, when we surrender to that authority, Lord, it means that we have surrendered to your lordship. And God, your lordship has proven in my life to be so good. Lord, you are a Lord who is worthy because you are trustworthy. You're a Lord who has proven yourself time and time again to know what is best for me. You have proven over and over again, God, that you can take whatever's bad and you can turn it for my good. Lord, you are worthy for me to call you Lord and for me to surrender my life to your lordship, my all to your allness. God, may I do that. Folks, if you're here this morning, you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, as your Lord, would you cry out to him silently and confess your sins? Confess your sins to Christ because you have sinned against a holy, perfect God. Would you trust him to be your Savior because he died in your place? He took the punishment that you deserved. He was the atonement. He died in your place. Would you say to him, Jesus, I accept you as my Lord? That means that I submit my life, every part of my life, to you. I surrender myself, my life, my all. I give it to you, Jesus. That means I want you to be the lead of my life. And I will submit and surrender to your authority because you are good. Jesus, with you, there is no abuse of authority. Your authority comes because you love us. But you know what is best for us. So we lovingly submit to the loving, kind, gracious authority of Jesus. May we do that right now. Now, Father, over these next few moments as we sing, remind us of how good you are. Remind us, Lord, that you are your Lord, and we submit to that this morning. We pray it now in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, let's stand together as we sing this song.
With me, I.
All right, church, that is a great reminder, isn't it? I tell you, in a day that we live in right now, that is a reminder, and that verse goes, that hymn goes back to a verse in Lamentations chapter 3. And if you know what's going on in Lamentations chapter 3, it is a sad state of affairs for Jerusalem that was besieged and taken over by the Babylonians. And Jeremiah is seeing the wreckage and the devastation, and his heart breaks. His heart breaks for his country. And he says, great God is your faithful. And your mercies are new every single morning. Listen, our heart breaks for our country. Don't forget, just as Jeremiah could say, and of course there's a complete difference between Israel and America, but I will tell you this, great God is still faithful. Amen. You can trust that. God's mercies can be new to you every single morning because God is faithful. Would you trust him to replenish you every single day with the stress and the anxiety sometimes that is coming with the burden that we often feel? So let's pray together and be reminded of that as we leave, okay? Let's pray. God, we're so grateful for your faithfulness, Lord, that we can trust and rest on the solid rock. Lord, that whatever comes our way, Lord, you are the one constant in our life. Lord, thank you that every single morning you can give us your brand new mercies, that brand new grace that we need, God, to help us in our time of need. And so, Lord, with all the burdens that we carry right now, Father, Father, remind us that you are faithful, and God, that you will give us your grace as we need it. May we walk out of this place this morning being reminded of that. May we live in that peace, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.